أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الصلاة والسلام على محمد وعلى الطيبين الطاهرين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته ليلة الجمعة مبارك. Well, this is our seventh Thursday. We're going to start with a surah from Juz 29. And today it's going to be Suratul Mudathir. Now, this is surah number 74. We will then look at an extract from Dua al-Kumayl. Then we'll look at the A to Z of Islam. And as I promised last week, we're still going to go for E for ethics. And it's going to be all about mom. Oh, my goodness. We'll talk a little bit about Dahwul Ardh, which is tomorrow, the 25th of Dhul-Qa'dah. And then, inshallah, if we have time, we will look at another section of Suratul Waaqia. So let's start with Suratul Mudathir. And before I look at it, let's just look at some key concepts of that surah. So Mudathir, remember when we talked about Muzammil? I told you how it was. When you say Zammiluni, it's like wrap yourself lovingly, snug as a bug in a rug. You remember that? Well, this is different. Mudathir means when you cover up because you're frightened or you're cold or you're just anxious. And you maybe if you tighten your coat around you, that's what Mudathir is all about. And Muzammil, remember, lovingly. It's like full of love. It's gentle. It's different. So I called one the wrapped one. And this one we will say the covered one. That's 54 ayat. It's a Makki surah. The focus of the surah is basically perseverance in transmitting the word of divinity. That means the tabligh that the Prophet had to do, that was tough. It wasn't easy. But here we find the perseverance. He's told, just continue doing what Allah has told you to do. We've divided the surah into four sections. Okay, so the first section is ayah 1 to 7. And here we see Allah telling the Prophet, declare His greatness, declare the greatness of Allah. Make sure your clothes are pure. Now some Mufassirin have said that means that surround yourself with people who are right, who are pure. Keep away from negative emotions, because the reaction of human beings when they hear the Quran will be different, because it will take their life, the life that they knew, away. They won't like it. But, you know, keep away from any sort of anger or anything that you might have against what they do. Don't let the enormity of this challenge, don't let it intimidate you. It's hard work. And then he's told, just persevere. In section 2, there is an example, a historical example, and this is from ayah 8 to 31, of someone who loved the Prophet. He was an intelligent man, an eloquent poet. His name was Walid ibn Mughira. Now, he was intelligent and he actually understood the Quran. He understood this was from divinity. He liked the Prophet as well. And Allah sort of describes his plot. Exactly what he plotted in his head. It's beautiful the way it's described. Because he was sent by the Quraysh to evaluate the Prophet. Because remember, he was this person who had a status. He was born into wealth. He was an only child. Allah said, we granted him lots of multiplied wealth. Lots of sons. Lots of children. But he was sent to deal with him. And when he went to evaluate the Prophet, he thought, my goodness, this is right. But if he were to submit to it, it would change his lifestyle. And he didn't like that at all. So he goes back knowing the truth. And he tells him, this is magic. This is not divine. This is just normal human beings. This is something he's been taught again and again. And then Allah confirms his place in Jahannam and describes it quite vividly. Section 3 is like the oaths on the moon and the night and the daybreak. And they emphasize the greatness of the Quran. And section 4, my goodness, it is a conversation between those in Jahannam explaining to those in Jannah why they are in Jahannam. And we've got to listen to this one. Number one, they say, we didn't pray. We didn't connect to Allah. We didn't feed the poor. We spent our lives in aimless activity. There's no goal. We just, you know, sort of dossed around a bit. We didn't believe in accountability. We didn't believe in the day of judgment. And this is the only surah where a lion is mentioned. But you know how it's mentioned? Allah says they ran away from divine guidance like donkeys run away from a lion. It's just amazing. And a lion is not called Asad here. It's called Kaswara. Look it up. It's amazing. I have a little sticker of a lion in my book for Mudathir. I wish I could show it to you. And it reminds me always. There, can you see it? Somewhere there. There you go. This side. There's a lion here. Can you see that? Okay. So if you've got your Qurans ready, let's read Suratul Mudathir together. You ready? And there's a shadda on the dh and the th. So it's Mudathir. Okay, ready? Okay. La ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah. A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Ya ayyuhal mudaththir qum fa'anzir wa rabbaka fakabbir wa thiyabaka fatahhir wal rujsa fahjur wa la tamnun tastakthir wa li rabbika fasbir فإذا نقر في الناقور فذلك يومئذ يوم عسير على الكافرين غير يسير ذرني ومن خلقت وحيدا وجعلت له مالا ممدودا وبنين شهودا ومهدت له تمهيدا ثم يطمع أن أزيد كلا إنه كان لآياتنا عنيدا سأرهقه صعودا إنه فكر وقدر فقتل كيف قدر ثم قتل كيف قدر ثم نذر ثم عبس وبصر ثم أدبر واستكبر فقال إن هذا إلا سحر يوثر إن هذا إلا قول البشر سأسليه سقر وما أدراك ما سقر لا تبقي ولا تذر لواحة للبشر عليها 19 وما جعلنا أصحاب النار إلا ملائكة وما جعلنا عدتهم إلا فتنة للذين كفروا ليستيقن الذين أوتوا الكتاب ويزداد الذين آمنوا إيمانا ولو يرتاب الذين أوتوا الكتاب والمؤمنون وليقول الذين في قلوبهم مرض الكافرون ماذا أراد الله بهذا مثلا كذلك يضل الله من يشاء ويهدي من يشاء وما يعلم جنود ربك إلا هو وما هي إلا ذكرى للبشر كلا والقمر والليل إذ أدبر والصبح إذا عسفر إنها لأحد الكبر نذيرا للبشر لمن شاء منكم أن يتقدم أو يتأخر كل نفس بما كسبت رهينة إلا أصحاب اليمين في جنات يتساءلون عن المجرمين ما سلككم في سقر قالوا لم نكن من المصلين ولم نكن نطعم المسكين وكنا نخوض مع الخائضين وكنا نكذب بيوم الدين حتى أتانا اليقين فما تنفعهم شفاعة الشافعين فما لهم عن التذكرة معرضين كأنهم حمر مستنفرة فرت من قسورة بل يريد كل امرئ منهم أن يؤتى صحفا منشرة كلا بل لا يخافون الآخرة كلا إنه تذكرة فمن شاء ذكر وما يذكرون إلا أن يشاء الله هو أهل التقوى وأهل المغفرة صدق الله العلي العظيم وصدق الرسول الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. We're now going to look at an extract from Dua al-Kumayl. Now you've been with me all this time, but I'm still going to repeat this. It's Dua al-Khidr. Remember, it was taught to Kumayl by Imam Ali alayhi salam. We also know that Khidr is at every Hajj. It keeps him. He keeps Imam Mahdi company. And when Imam Ali taught it to Kumayl and entrusted it to him, he just marketed it so well that instead of knowing it as Dua al-Khidr, we know it as Dua al-Kumayl. So let's see where we left off. And where we're going to start now is where it starts off with وَكُنِ اللَّهُمَّ بِإِزَّتِكَ. So if you're ready, let's go over each of the ayat and then we're going to read it, okay? So it starts off by وَكُنِ اللَّهُمَّ بِإِزَّتِكَ. And by your might, O Allah. We're asking Allah with his izzah, which is ultimate authority. What are we telling him? فِي كُلِّ الْأَحْوَالِ رَعُوفَ. So in absolutely everything of mine, every state of mine, every condition of mine, can you be extremely kind? Ra'uf is kinder than Rahim. It's like really, really kind. Can you be kind to me in everything? Wa alayya fi jami'il umuri atufa. You know, Jamil is beautiful. And in everything I do, make it be really lovely. Be gracious, be beautiful. And then we say, Ilahi wa Rabbi. Oh my God and my Master. Man li ghayruk. Who else do I have? As'aluhu kashfa dhurri. Whom I can ask. Who else do I have to ask? Who can find a cure for my difficulties, for my afflictions? Wa nadhara fi amri. And who will look at my affairs with a divine eye. Ilahi wa maulaya. Oh my God and my protector. Ajrayta alayya hukman. I have passed judgment on myself. I've limited myself. Ittaba'tu fihi hawa nafsi. Because I followed what my soul said. I followed the desires of my soul. Walam ahtaris fihi min tadhnini aduwi. And I didn't defend myself from my enemy, which is myself, my thoughts, my desires. I didn't listen to you, Ya Allah. I followed me. Fagharrani bima ahwa. And it deceived me. It deluded me. What I thought wasn't what right. It was supposed to be what you thought. وَأَسْعَدُهُ عَلَىٰ ذَٰلِكَ الْقَذَىٰ. And it sort of helped because of the way I thought. It helped me to a future that wasn't very good. And then you admit to him, you say, فَتَجَاوَزْتُ بِمَا جَرَىٰ. I actually crossed some lines. So, فَتَجَاوَزْتُ بِمَا جَرَىٰ عَلَيَّ مِنْ ذَٰلِكَ بَعْدَ أَوَامِرِكَ. So you say, so I crossed these lines and disobeyed some of your commands. So this basic part is this bit that we're looking at. We're saying, be kind to me. I'm sorry, but I did cross my lines and I did just follow myself. I didn't follow you. And as we go along, we'll see how we're saying, I need to come back to you. So if you're ready, let's read Dua al-Kumayl until this last bit, which we stop, which is وَخَالَفْتُ بَعْضَ أَوَامِرِكَ. Okay, and so I sort of crossed these lines and I basically didn't listen to you. Right, you ready? Let's go. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma inni as'aluka bi rahmatika allati wasi'at kull shay wa bi quwwatika allati qaharta biha kull shay wa qada'a laha kull shay وذل لها كل شيء وبجبروتك التي غلبت بها كل شيء وبعزتك التي لا يقوم لها شيء وبعظمتك التي ملعت كل شيء وبسلطانك الذي على كل شيء وبوجهك الباقي بعد فناء كل شيء وبأسمائك التي ملأت أركان كل شيء وبعلمك الذي أحاط بكل شيء وبنور وجهك الذي أضاء له كل شيء يا نور يا قدوس يا أول الأولين ويا آخر الآخرين اللهم اغفر لي الذنوب التي تهتك العصم اللهم اغفر لي الذنوب التي تنزل النقم اللهم اغفر لي الذنوب التي تغير النعم اللهم اغفر لي الذنوب التي تحبس الدعاء اللهم اغفر لي الذنوب التي تقطع الرجاء اللهم اغفر لي الذنوب التي تنزل البلاء اللهم اغفر لي كل ذنب أذنبته وكل خطية نقطعتها اللهم إني أتقرب إليك بذكرك واستشفئ بك إلى نفسك وأسألك بجودك أن تدنيني من قربك وأن توزيني شكرك وأن تلهمني ذكرك. اللهم إني أسألك سؤال خاذل متذلل خاشع أن تسامحني وترحمني وتجعلني بقسمك راضيا قانيا وفي جميع الأحوال متواضيا. اللهم وأسألك سؤال من اشتدت فاقته وأنزل بك عند الشدائد حاجته وعظم فيما عندك رغبته. اللهم عظم سلطانك وعلى مكانك وخفي مكرك وظهر أمرك وغلب كحرك وجرت قدرتك ولا يمكن الفرار من حكومتك. اللهم لا أجد لذنوبي غافرا ولا لقبائه ساترا ولا لشيء من عملي القبيح بالحسن مبدلا غيرك. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك وبحمدك ظلمت نفسي وتجرعت بجهلي وسكنت إلى قديم ذكرك لي ومنك علي. اللهم مولاي كم من قبيح سترت وكم من فاته من البلاء قلت وكم من إثار وقيت وكم من مكروه دفعت وكم من ثناء جميل لست أهلا له نشرت. اللهم عظم بلائي وعفرت بي سوء حالي وقصرت بي أعمالي وقعدت بي أغلالي وحبسني النفع بعد عملي وخدعتني الدنيا بغرورها ونفسي بجنايتها ومتالي. يا سيدي فأسألك بعزتك ألا يحجب عنك دعائي سوء عملي وفعالي ولا تفضحني بخفي ما اطلعت عليه من سري ولا تعاجلني بالعقوبة على ما عملته في خلواتي من سوء فعلي وإساءتي ودوام تفريتي وجهالتي وقثرة شهواتي وغفلتي. وكن اللهم بعزتك لي في كل الأحوال رؤوفا وعلي في جميع الأمور عطوفا. إلهي وربي من لي غيرك أسأله كشف ضري والنذر في أمري. إلهي ومولاي أجريت علي حكما اتبعت فيه هوى نفسي ولم أحترس فيه من تزييني عدوي فغرني بما أهوى وأسعده على ذلك القضاء فتجاوزت بما جرى علي من ذلك بعض حدودك وخالفت بعض أوامرك. We'll continue with Dua al-Kumayl inshallah next week. But now we're going to look at E4 ethics. So let's start with A4, Allah. B4, best. C4, charity. D4, da'a. And E4, ethics. And remember last week I said, today it's going to be all about mom. Okay? And it's really important. Well, parents, but I'm going to focus on mom. So Allah and Suratul Isra says, وَقَذَا رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُ إِلَّا إِيَّا. And your Rabb has decreed, that means it's done deal, it's written for you, that you will only be his abd, only his slave. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانَ. But to your parents, you will do ihsan. I'm going to tell you what ihsan means, okay? So say, for example, I had £2. And my neighbor had none. If I gave my neighbor £1, then that is my duty, that's my responsibility. When I give my neighbor both, it is called ihsan. So when Allah says, wa bil walidayhi, to your parents, there's ihsan. There is no two ways about it. You have no choice. He is ordering you and me for our parents to be able to do that. But I said, like I said, I'm going to talk about mom. So I'm going to tell you a few stories about mom so we understand. These are stories that all my life I've held there. Okay. So there was a young man and he looked after his mom when she was old, 24/7, 24 hours a day. And one day she said, I want to go visit the Kaaba. So at that time, it wasn't like today where you could have maybe a wheelchair or be able to have facilities. There wasn't anything like that. He carried her on his back. He brought her all the way to Makkah, to the Kaaba. He traveled for days with her on his back and he looked after her. She couldn't walk. And when he got to Makkah, he did the tawaf of the Kaaba and the Prophet was there. And he told the Prophet, have I fulfilled my responsibility to my mom? I carried her although I've been looking after all the time. And the Prophet said to him, not even for one night's rocking of the cradle. Not even for one night. And he said, how so? How so? It's easier to look after a baby than it's looking after an older person. And the Prophet said, when she was looking after you, she prayed for your life. She would give her life to you. But you're looking after her thinking, how long is this going to last? She prayed for you to live forever. You're thinking, well, these are her last days. There are so many stories. Prophet Musa, for example, he's climbing this mountain. Remember we talked about him. He's climbing Mount Sinai. And Jibreel comes and says, Musa, slowly, 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 slowly. And he says, why? Every time you let me go so fast up this mountain, because I want to chat to Allah. Remember we said this was Arba'in Kalamiyah, when Prophet Musa is talking to Allah. We're still part of Arba'in Kalamiyah, still the Al-Qa'da. And he's talking to him. And Jibreel says, slow, low, slow, 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 calm down. And he said, why? He said, Musa, your mama died today. Her name was Yuqabid. She's died today. The woman who used to do dua for you at every waking moment, she's gone. Musa, now you've got to look after yourself. You've got to go very, very slowly. A man came to the Prophet and he said, I can't sleep at night. I'm really troubled. And the Prophet said, why? And he said, well, I'm one of those people who buried my daughters alive. Can you imagine? And he said, all I can hear in my ears are her last words when she said, Ya Abi, oh my dad, and I buried her. And the Prophet said, is your mom alive? He said, no. So the Prophet said, you know what? Is your mom's sister alive? Is your Masi alive? And he said, yes. And the Prophet said, go serve her all your life. That's the only way you can be forgiven. Let me tell you another one. There was a man who came to the Prophet and he said, everything's going nuts, you know, nothing's working. Nothing's working at all. So the Prophet said, have you got a mom? And he said, no. Do you know your mom's grave is? And he said, no. So the Prophet said, go to your backyard, to your back garden, draw a line, make a niyyah that that's your mom's grave and pray, ask Allah with the wasila of your mom and see how things will get better. It really does work. You know, one of our greatest scholars was called Sayyid Murtaza Ansari. And Sayyid Murtaza Ansari, when his mom died, he was crying so much. His students came up to him and said, you know, she was old. She had to die. Why are you crying? You know, you can't do that because you're the person who tells us all the time to do sabr and not cry. He said, how can I not cry? It is her hard work. It is her training. It is her hardship that has brought me to where I am. When the Prophet cried, when Imam Ali's mom, Fatima bint Asad, died because she looked after him. And everybody said, you're crying. And he said, eyes were made to cry. Hearts were made to hurt. I'm not complaining to God for taking her, but I miss my mom. So you know what? I mean, look after your moms like anything. And I was reading somewhere the other day, and I got to tell it to you. So everybody says, the Prophet said, okay, so everybody repeats it, when he said that Jannah is under the feet of my moms. Have you heard that before? Okay, so Jannah is under the feet of your moms. So this scholar writes, there's a reason why Jannah wasn't given to moms in her hands. Because if it was given to her in her hands, she would have handed it over to you. That's her selfless love. But Allah placed it under her feet. It is the ground that bears her weight. And if you want Jannah, then carry a bit of her weight for her. And Jannah will be yours. It's awesome. So you know what? Your first akhlaq, your first ethics is to look after your mom. That's your first ethic. Before you go anywhere, you can't talk loudly to her. You can't raise your voice. My father died when I was 10. But one thing that I always remember that he taught me was, I remember we used to have sehri together in the morning. And my mom used to bring us sehri. She wouldn't eat. She would just have a glass of water. But she would stand in somewhere in the balcony, I remember. And my father too would point to her and he would tell me, this woman, you will never hurt her. Never. You do anything else in the world, but you will never hurt her. Because that's the awesomeness of her mom. Things will always work out if you look after your mom. There's another hadith which says, you could be the most awesome human being in the world. Awesome. You could do so much. But if you do not respect the womb that bears you, that means your mama, you will not even smell the fragrance of Jannah. And allegedly, you can smell the fragrance from a distance of 500 years, 500,000 years, some hadith say. So really careful. That's your first. The way you behave to your mom, when people came to the Prophet and said, you know, how do we know who we should marry, for example? And he would say, see how they talk about their parents. See how they treat their moms. And see how their moms react to them or how they react to them. If you find that they do not say good about their parents, then run away like donkeys run away from lions. Just what we did in Surah Al-Muddathir. So that's mom. Next week we will look at F. Do you know what F is for? You're right. Furu al-Din. And we will look at the branches of religion. But before I go on to Surah Al-Waqia, I'd like to look at Dahwul Ardh. Now Dahwul Ardh is the 25th of Dhul-Qa'dah. And Dahwul Ardh literally means the spreading of the earth. If you look at Surah An-Naziat, and we did that sometime in the month of Ramadan, I think, when we looked at Surah An-Naziat, and that surah number 79, Allah says, "Wal ardi," and the earth, and then he says, and he who spread it, dahaha is the word they use. It's the same thing. And maybe I can talk about it as Earth Day. Because we, you know, it's talking about the conservation of the earth. The earth for us is an amana. It's been given to us as a trust for future generations. So Earth Day has been happening on the 22nd of April of every year since 1970. So when human beings were outraged, people were hated, the oil spills, the pollution, 20 million people took to the streets and they protested against the environment. Okay, what was happening to the environment, the crisis that was happening there. In fact, in 2009, the United Nations adopted a resolution and it recognized the day as International Mother Earth Day. It's known as Mother Earth, right? And on Earth Day 2016, they adopted the Paris Agreement, which was to limit global temperatures. You must have all heard about climate change. That's all part of Earth Day. And that's Dahwul Ardh. It's talking about the spreading of the earth, how we can conserve the earth, how we can respect the earth that bears us, right? We are on this earth. So what can we do? There are some amals, but you know what? The amals have been translated into practicality. So let me give you some things that are recommended by those who started Earth Day. So April 22nd of this year marked 50 years of Earth Day. So let me give you a little bit of something that we might be able to do. Do you recycle? Did you know that one toilet paper tube, the paper one, the cardboard one, takes 2 months to decompose in a landfill? So recycle it. A plastic bottle takes over 450 years to break down. Did you know that? So you could use it as something else. Before you throw it away, see if you can recycle them. Another thing is plant a tree. The Prophet said that when you plant a tree, I mean, it does forgiveness for you till the time, whatever time it lives, all the leaves on there. And the shade it gives, the people will give you the thawabs for it. And the fruit, my goodness, it's like thawab ijari, continuous thawab. You know, Imam Ali was walking around with a bag and everybody said, "Ya Ali, what's in your bag?" And he said, "There's a forest in my bag." And they all sort of followed him on to see, how can a forest fit in a bag? And when he opened his little bag, it had seeds. He would not see the shade of the trees or the trees that grew from the seeds that he planted, but somebody else would benefit from them. That's part of Dahwul Ardh. Don't waste water. Close it. Turn off the lights when you have to. And spread the message of Dahwul Ardh. That's what it's about. Now, if you look at Mafatih al-Jinan or all the dua books, or even if you Google it, you will find the namaz that's got to be recited and the fast. You might be able to fast tomorrow. But in essence, it's talking about respect of the earth. Okay. Well, let's look at Surah Al-Waqia. And I will repeat what I said last week because we've got to remember all the things. 96 ayat, it's a Makki surah. One who recites Surah Al-Waqia will be loved by Allah and people. It's safe from sadness. And it's a surah dedicated to Imam Ali. And you'll be in his company if you recite the surah. Basically, remember what we said about Quran. It was read, internalize or memorize, understand, apply, and teach. It's forgiveness of sins. If you want sustenance, according to the lunar date. So whatever date it is today, it's the 24th of Dhulqa'dah, they read it 24 times. Maybe you can wait till the first, so you have to read it one time. But hey, it's good to recite it again and again and again. And you'll be never afflicted by need if you read Surah Al-Waqia. Now, last week, we looked at section one. I told you there were seven sections. And the first sections were the three group of people on the Day of Judgment. Do you remember them? The companions of the right, what were they called? Do you know? Ashabul Maymana. The companions of the left, do you know what they were called? Any idea? Ashabul Mash'ama. Okay, so it was Yamin and Shimal, do you remember? And the third, my goodness, those were the winners, Sabiqun. Now, do you remember that? Yes, and we did that in Ayah 1 to 11. So today, we're going to look at Ayah 12 to 40. And we're going to look at a tour of Jannah. This is the reward of Jannah for the winners and the awesome companions of the right. So let's look at each of the ayat and see if we can understand them all, a little bit, at least know what we're talking about. And these are two levels of Jannah. So it starts off by saying, "Fi jannatin na'im." They will be in this Jannah which has continuous bliss. It doesn't stop, it's constant, it's continuous. "Thullatun min al-awwalin," a large number from the winners, "wa qalilan min al-akhirin," and some from the companions of the right. Now, there's lots of meanings for this, but let's just look at this. Let's imagine a whole lot going there. "Ala sururin mawdhuna," my goodness, they will be on beds. Mawdhuna is like woven tightly, decorated, but I would say bespoke springs. So nothing hurts. You remember the story about the princess and the pea? No peas on your bed. It's going to be so comfortable. "Muttaqina alayha mutakabilin," they'll be reclining on them and they'll be able to see each other. This is awesome. Okay, so now we talked about where they're going to relax. Now it talks about the Jannah catering company. It says, "Yatufu alayhim wildanum mukhalladun," there'll be all these young people walking around them. "Biaqwabin wa abariq wa ka'sin min ma'in," basically with cups of drink that you might want. "La yusadda'un anha wa la yunzifun," you know, they don't get exhausted. "Wa faqihatin mimma yatakhayyarun," there will be fruits that you will actually love, that make you smile, bring you delight. "Wa lahmi tayrin mimma yashtahun," and the sort of meat from birds, you know, chicken maybe, something like that. But yashtahun means you'll be able to customize your order. Exactly what you want. So we've got the catering done. We've got our position where we sit, you know, our homes done, the catering done. Now he talks about the company. "Hurun in," my goodness, sort of enchanting, focused. People whose eyes will be focused on you and you'll love it. Your company will be like that. Your spouses, you could look at that. "Kamthali lu'lu'il maknoon," like hidden pearls. They'll be exclusive to you. "Jazaan bima kanu ya'malun," that is compensation of what you did. "La yasma'una fiha laghwan wala ta'thima," there'll be no nonsense. You won't hear nonsense in it or anything that takes you towards sin. Ithm, ta'thiman, it's from ithm. "Illa qilan salaman salama," you'll only be at peace. My goodness, can you imagine? So Allah's trying to describe this Jannah. Then he says, "Washabul Yameen." Now he doesn't say washabul maymana. He says washabul yameen and the companions of the right hand. Mashabul yameen. So basically saying now these people, yameen is sort of, it's more people than maymana. So even those who barely made it, like they got 51%, they're still there. Okay. Then he says, "Fi sidrim makhdood," they will be with lotus trees. Now lotus trees are supposed to have thorns, but he says maqdud, there will be no thorns on them. This is a metaphor of explaining. Watalhim mandud, and trees that will be filled with fruit. Wadhillim mamdud, there'll be lots of shade. Wama'im maskub, and constantly flowing water. Wafaqihatin kathira, and fruit that brings delight. La maqtu'atin wa la mamnu'a, there is nothing that will not be allowed. You won't say, oh God, this is going to make me fat, or this is not going to work, or this is not healthy. All of it will be good for you. And then he says, wafurushim marfu'a, so they will be these carpets, or can I say settees, which will be raised. Now, if you think about the nomadic Arab, for example, used to carry tents. And in tents, you can't have settees that are raised. You had to have spread them out on the floor so you could roll it up and take it. When it says they're raised, it means there's permanence. So you won't be moved out of it. Inna ansha'nahunna insha'a. There will be a unique form that you will be. Faja'alnahunna abkara. And there will be exclusivity. So there will be ones who will, you know, your companions will be only yours. Urban atraba. There will be a perfect match to you. Li ashabil yameen. For the companions of the right hand. And who will they be? Thullatun min al-awwalin. A large group from the first. And now he says, وَثُلَّةٌ مِّنَ الْآخَرِينَ A large group from the last as well. In the first part, we heard about a small group from the last. He also says there's loads of people. All those who have done good. All those who have tried their best, in other words, in attaching themselves to Allah. So let's pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of them. And with that, let's recite Surah Al-Waqia until Ayah 14. Are you ready? It's Surah number 56. And recite with me. Okay, I've got my Quran. I hope you have. And we're going to recite it together. Okay, let's start. La ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah. A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Idha waqa'atil waqi'a, laysa liwaqa'atiha kathiba. خافضة رافعة إذا رجت الأرض رجا وبست الجبال بسا فكانت هباء منبثا وكنتم أزواجا ثلاثة فأصحاب الميمنة ما أصحاب الميمنة وأصحاب المشعمة ما أصحاب المشعمة والسابقون السابقون أولئك المقربون في جنات النعيم ثلة من الأولين وقليل من الآخرين على سرر موضونة متقئين عليها متقابلين يتوف عليهم ولدان مخلدون بأقواب وعباريك وكأس من معين لا يصدعون عنها لا يصدعون عنها ولا ينزفون وفاكهة مما يتخيرون ولحم طير مما يشتهون وهور عين كأمثال اللؤلؤ المكنون جزاء بما كانوا يعملون لا يسمعون فيها لغوا ولا تأثيما إلا قيلا سلاما سلاما وأصحاب اليمين ما أصحاب اليمين في صدر مخضود وتلح منضود وظل ممدود وماء مسكوب وفاقهة كثيرة لا مقطوعة ولا ممنوعة وفرش مرفوعة إنا أنشأناهن إنشاء فجعلناهن أبكارا عربا أترابا لأصحاب اليمين ثلة من الأولين وثلة من الآخرين صدق الله العلي العظيم وصدق الرسول الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين. So let's pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who are the winners, the Sabiqoon. Inshallah, we will continue with this next Thursday. I hope tomorrow in Dahwul Ardh, you read up what you have to do, but basically think about conserving the earth. Let us end now with the Surah Al-Fatiha for all the marhumin, especially those of our family. Remember, it's the night of Friday. Really important time to remember them. We pray for those who are ill, and we pray for those who are in difficulty. We will then read the dua for protection. And finally, the last thing we're going to do is recite the ziyara of Abu Abdullah. You ready? Okay. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Ar Rahmanir Rahim. Malik Yawmid الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. Close your eyes, ask Allah to give the thawabs to all the marhumin, especially those of your family. Pray for those who are ill and those who are in trouble. لي خمسة عطفي بها هر الوباء الحاتمة المصطفى والمرتضى وأبناهما والفاطمة لي خمسة عطفي بها هر الوباء الحاتمة المصطفى والمرتضى وأبناهما والفاطمة السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي هلت بفنائك عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد في أمان الله قريب إن شاء الله see you next week جزاكم الله خير ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم